I'll praise in the valley, praise on the mountain. I'll praise when I'm sure, and praise when I'm doubting. I'll praise when outnumbered, praise when surrounded. 'Cause praise is the water my enemies drown in. As long as I'm breathing, I've got a reason to praise the Lord, oh my soul. Praise the Lord, oh my soul. I'll praise when I feel it, praise when I don't. I'll praise 'cause I know you're still in control. 'Cause my praise is a weapon, it's more than a sound. My praise is the shout that brings Jericho down. As long as I'm breathing, I've got a reason to praise the Lord, oh my soul. Praise the Lord, oh my soul. I won't be quiet, my God is alive. How could I keep it inside? Praise the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. I'll praise 'cause you're sovereign, praise 'cause you reign, praise 'cause you rose and defeated the grave. I'll praise 'cause you're faithful, praise 'cause you're true, praise 'cause there's nobody greater than you. I'll praise 'cause you're sovereign, praise 'cause you reign, praise 'cause you rose and defeated the grave. I'll praise 'cause you're faithful, praise 'cause you're true, praise 'cause there's nobody greater than you. I'll praise the Lord, oh my soul. 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 I won't be quiet, my God is alive. How could I keep it inside? I won't be quiet, my God is alive. How could I keep it inside? I won't be quiet, my God is alive. How could I keep it inside? Praise the Lord, oh my soul.
Who am I that the highest King would welcome me? I was lost, but he brought me in. Oh, his love for me. Oh, his love for me. Who the sun sets free. Oh, is free. Free at last. has ransomed me. His grace runs deep. While I was a slave, sin, Jesus died for me. Yes, he died for me. When the sun sets free, oh, it's free.
Were creation suddenly articulate with a thousand tongues to lift one cry? Then from north to south and east to west, we'd hear Christ be magnified. Were the whole earth echoing his imminence, his name would burst from sea and sky. And from rivers to the mountain tops, we'd hear Christ be magnified. Oh, Christ be magnified, and let his praise arise. And Christ be magnified in me. Oh, Christ be magnified from the altar of my life. And Christ be magnified in me. Every creature finds its inmost melody, in every human heart its native cry. Then in one enraptured hymn of praise, we'll sing Christ be Stand strong and worship you. And if it puts me in the fire, then I'll rejoice because you're there too. No, I won't be formed by feelings. I'll hold fast to what is true. And if the cross brings transformation, then I'll be crucified with you. Because death is just a doorway to resurrection life. If I join you in your sufferings, then I'll join you in your rise. And when you return in glory with all the angels and the saints, my heart will still be singing, my song will be the same. Oh, Christ be magnified, let his praise arise. Christ be magnified in me. Oh, Christ be magnified in the altar of my life. Christ be magnified in me. Oh, Christ be magnified. Let his praise arise. Christ be magnified in me. Oh, Christ be magnified in the altar of my life. Christ be magnified in me.
Everybody, it's another glorious day to be in God's house and magnify the Lord. I love that last song. We get to magnify the Lord. Hopefully, that's the agenda this morning, is that we've all come to magnify the Lord. Now, I'm not to be magnified. You're not to be magnified. The Lord is to be magnified. And so, hopefully, that's our agenda this morning. If you come with any other agenda, it's not too late to change it. Amen? And so, again, we're thankful, as always, to have each and every one of you that are here. If you're a guest, your first time to be at Cornerstone, we're so blessed to have you with us today. As always, we're thankful for those that are joining us live or will join us online later and check out what God is doing here at Cornerstone in this particular service. We're in week three of Anxiety Society, and I don't know about you, but sometimes I feel like the guy with the tennis racket. Things just come at you so fast, and before you know it, you're on your back looking straight up, right? And sometimes that happens. And I always get anxiety when I have to preach messages about anxiety, or I have to preach messages about fear or patience or things like that, because I always know that in some way, shape, or form, while I'm preaching this in this series, I'm going to have to face anxiety at some point, right? Or fear or patience or any of those things. And so this has been no different. But thankfully, the Word teaches us, and Jesus teaches us in His teachings and in His preachings how to handle all of those things and how to walk through those things. So let's turn to Matthew chapter 6. Matthew chapter 6 is where we're going to be. We're going to be back in verse 28. We'll read 28 through 30 this morning. We've read 19 through 27 up to this point. So if you're behind or you've had to miss a message, you can go back and read those passages of Scripture and see what Jesus is teaching and preaching in his Sermon on the Mount. But anxiety, worry, fret, distress, agitation, tension, irritability, words that describe feelings of an inner turmoil that result in outward uneasiness. Outward uneasiness. Probably everybody here has faced that. Maybe you're facing it this morning. But those words describe common feelings among people as we consider what the future holds, not only for ourselves, but for our loved ones. And I'm going to use a line from Chad Baker. I see him out there this morning. We had lunch with Chad Baker, and he said, you know, the Bible says not to worry about tomorrow, but it didn't say anything about today. Or something to that effect. You can get the exact quote from him. But he said something, I was like, you know, that's a good point. You made a good point there. And so, a lot of times the future worries us. A lot of times the future can cause us anxiety. Even knowing that my future, because of my relationship with Jesus Christ, is set. That I have a glorious future, an amazing future. Sometimes the enemy, or sometimes even God, or life itself just presents things. Or, you know, as a pastor, sometimes you see things and you hear things and you're just like, that's not the future. If that continues, that's not the future that we want to be a part of. It's not the future that God wants His church to be a part of. And so that can cause us anxiety. It can cause us distress, agitation, tension, and irritability. It can cause a feeling of inner turmoil, And so we look at those and we sometimes worry about the future. Anxiety causes feelings and emotions that affect our perspective, that affect our perspective, our decision making. We probably made 100 decisions before we got here this morning, little ones and big ones. And so anxiety can affect the way we see things, the way we decide on things and circumstances, and ultimately those decisions will affect the direction of our life. The first week we talked about what we value. What is important to you? What do you prioritize? What is number one on the list of priorities in your life? And we talked about how we should not value earthly or temporary things over godly, heavenly, or eternal things. And a lot of times we go right to the materialistic. And even in my preaching the first week, I went to materialistic things. But there's some other things that we need to value over the temporary things. And one of those things is peace. We need to value peace. We need to value peace in our lives to the point that we will take whatever measure necessary to maintain peace. And sometimes anxiety wells up in us and it tries to destroy our peace. We need to value God's way. We'll touch on that here in just a second. Not my way, not a group of people's way, but God's way. We need to value that over the temporary things. And then we talked about how our eyes, what we see, affect our heart. And we are exposed to so much. You can see just about anything nowadays, good and evil. And what we see, what we look upon, affects our heart. It affects our hearts. And then, what is your master? What is your master? Whether we want to admit it or not, whether we even realize it or not, we all have some sort of master in our life. Things that we serve. The Bible sometimes uses the word idols. And yeah, you may not have a golden calf sitting on your mantle above your fireplace, but there are things that we can have in our lives that become idols, that we prioritize over our relationship with Jesus, that we prioritize over His way, that we prioritize over heavenly things and eternal things. And so what is your master? What we crave, we will chase. What we crave, we will chase, and what we chase, we will end up serving. Last week we talked about don't stress the mess. And that's easier said than trust me right now. That's easier to preach. That rolls off the tongue real easy. But really functioning in that's hard. That's hard because life is messy. Life is messy. This world is messy. And sitting up here or standing up here this morning and saying, don't stress the mess, that's fun to say. It's easy to say. But actually living that is hard. Is hard. And so, but we talked about that, and God gave us a blueprint. Jesus gave us a blueprint of how we're not to stress. The fact of the matter is things are going to be messy from time to time. But we can't let the anxiety of the mess cause stress that changes our perspective and our outlook. And our outlook to change the future. If God provide, we talked about last week, if God provides for the birds, don't we think He will provide for our needs as His crown jewel creation? Even when things aren't exactly the way that I want them to be, even when things are messy, He still provides. He still provides. Even in the mess, I can have peace, knowing that He's going to provide for me, yes, physically, but more important than that, spiritually. Spiritually. Because I don't care what you got physically, if the spiritual is out of whack, everything's going to be out of whack. And so let's jump into this today, and let's talk about and examine our roots. Our roots. We talked a little bit about this last year in our hashtag, but let's read in Matthew 6, verse 28. Matthew 6, verse 28 says, "Why do you worry? Why do you worry about clothing? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow, neither toil nor spin." Verse 29, "And yet I say to you that even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. Now if God so clothes the grass of the field, which today is and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, will He not much more clothe you, O you of little faith?" O you of little faith. Let's pray this morning. Dear Heavenly Father, we come to You today. We just praise You and thank You for Your many blessings. We praise You and thank You for Your Word. Lord, we thank You that we don't have to pick up the burden of worry in our lives, that we can lay it upon Your shoulders and at Your feet. Lord, we just pray right now that You take this passage, Lord, and that You would begin to seed our hearts so that Your root can take place in our lives. Lord, we want to magnify You today. We want to glorify You today. In Jesus' name, amen. So here in this passage of Scripture, in this part of Jesus' Sermon on the Mount, He brings up the word worry again. And then he goes into clothing and those. And when Jesus asks them to consider the lilies, a flower, a plant, He's not talking about trying to keep up with the latest fashion trends or... But all that can apply in some sense. Nor is He suggesting that clothes aren't important. So far as His immediate audience right here was concerned. And in those days and in their culture, clothes were a vital thing because they didn't have Amazon Prime that they could pull up and order anything that they wanted. They didn't have Sheen or Shine or however you say that. Right? They didn't have any of that. They didn't have the Amazon Prime truck backing up and dumping boxes of clothes out at their cave or their tent. No, it was a legitimate concern for them. A lot of them, the middle class, they had one set, one pair of clothes. They wore it every single day. And a lot of them had anxiety, like when this set wears out, I've got to go down to the tailor, or maybe if I'm blessed, I got somebody in my family that can make me up some things, but you had to pay for it. That stuff wasn't free. And so in the audience that He was talking to, that was a legitimate concern for them, was where's my next set of clothes going to come from? So that's why He uses the and asks the question about clothing. It was a legitimate concern for us. Now, us today, at least us here in the United States, some of you have probably got clothes in your closet that you haven't worn in years. My problem is it don't fit anymore. You know, you see on I don't have Facebook, don't want Facebook. I don't. If y'all want Facebook, fine. You just be careful. But
I'll sneak on Amy's every once in a while just to see what you guys are doing. I think they call that a creeper. You can call me a creep. I don't care. Right? Just to make sure everybody's on the up and up. Right? And every once in a while, you'll get, what, shop at my closet or whatever that thing is. Right? And somebody will have their clothes out there that's still got tags on it. They bought it 6 months ago, never wore it. Now they're selling it again. We're blessed. Why are we worrying about clothes? Amen? Amen? And so, but the people of the time, they didn't have all that. They were legitimately concerned about that. And so, Jesus begins to speak to them in something that they understand and a legitimate concern, probably something that would cause them anxiety in their days. And so, what Jesus was more concerned about, though, than them worrying about their clothing was their root system. That's why he brings up the lily of the field, the flower, their root system. He was more concerned about that, how they grow and where that growth comes from. How they grow and where that growth comes from. You do a little research into a lily, and the roots run deep. The roots run deep. And I got to ask, what are you rooted to today? What are you attached to? What are you attached to? What are you? Are you rooted in the world, or are you rooted in Jesus Christ? And Jesus is teaching right here, when you're rooted in the world, you're going to have anxiety about your clothes. When you're rooted in the world, you're going to have anxiety about peace and joy that can only come from the Lord. Because the world, being attached to the world, cannot offer joy and peace. That can only come through Jesus Christ. And so, what are you rooted to? Where do your roots run deep? What is the purpose of a root system? Let's do a little bit of science here. Roots absorb water and nutrients from the soil. They give that lily the opportunity to grow and be as grand and amazing and beautiful as God created it to be. They anchor that plant firmly. Oh, there's a spiritual context to that. When we're rooted in the world, our roots, and we are delicate. The first storm, the first crisis, the first adversity that comes our way, and when we're rooted in the world, we will be destroyed. We will be knocked over, blown over. But when we are rooted firmly and anchored firmly in Jesus Christ, let the winds blow. Let the storms come. Let the enemy rage, because I'm rooted and I'm grounded in Jesus Christ, and there is no storm and there is no wind that can destroy me in the name of Jesus Christ. When we are rooted in the world, when the winds come and the storms blow, anxiety sets in because we know we're attached to the wrong thing. Roots help in storing food and nutrients. Roots transport water and minerals to the plant. Roots help prevent erosion. Roots help prevent erosion. Roots that run deep help prevent erosion. That is the bottom line of what the enemy wants to use anxiety for. The enemy wants to present anxiety into your life so that your relationship with God will begin to erode. He wants to erode your relationship with Jesus, with God the Father, and with the Holy Spirit. And if we are rooted in anything else other than a relationship with Jesus, that mission will be accomplished. He wants to erode the relationship with God. The other thing that the root system do provides sustenance and a habitat for other various organisms. There's other organisms that take part in the thriving or the flourishing of the root system of the lily. Well, guess what? Us as Christians, if we're rooted in thriving, we'll go back to last year. If we're rooted in thriving, guess what? Others see that. We'll go into this year. When we're shining because of our rootedness in Jesus Christ, we shine that light on others. Amen? And now we get to affect and provide something through Jesus Christ for somebody else.
for somebody else. It provides sustenance and sustainability. Sustainability. Turn over to Colossians chapter 2. Colossians chapter 2, verses 6 and 7. Colossians chapter 2, verses 6 and 7 say this. As you therefore have received Christ Jesus, the Lord, so walk in Him. Now, I want you to notice in 6 and then in the beginning of verse 7, there's three things that we need to make sure we're doing. And these, I'm going to say these are three roots that we need to have in our heart. Three roots that we need to have in our heart. Verse 6, again, as you therefore have received. The first root is we must receive Jesus Christ. Amen? If you have not received Jesus Christ as your Savior today, I encourage you and challenge you and implore you to do that. There's not a better or bigger decision you can make in this life than asking Jesus to be your Savior. The most important decision you'll ever make. The greatest decision you'll ever make. To receive Him. And when you do that, He becomes your Savior, but He also becomes your guide and your leader and your King. Amen. And so there's the first root is receive Christ Jesus the Lord. So walk in Him. Walk in Him. Not in me, not in yourself, not one foot in the world and one foot with Jesus. Walk in Him totally and completely. That's the second root. Walk in Jesus. Walk in Jesus's. What does that mean? That means pick up His ways. Pick up His thoughts. Pick up His wisdom and walk in it. Or in other words, operate in it. Live it out. Live it out. We can come in here and play church all day long. We can come in here and play church all day long. But we've got to live out the Word of God. And in order for us to do that, we got to let that root grow. We got to let that root grow within our heart. First, we got to receive Him as Lord, and then we got to walk in His ways. And then verse 7, it says, rooted. We've got to let those roots, we've got to let that run deep. Run deep. So we do that. We receive Him. We walk in His ways, and we allow His Word to be rooted in our hearts and in our lives so that we're functioning in that. So that's where, if we let the Word of God, if we let Jesus's relationship with us, if we let His ways root in our heart, we will receive nutrients. We will receive wisdom. We will receive guidance. We will receive joy. We will receive peace no matter what storm we're walking through. No matter what trial we're going through. No matter what temptation we're going through. No matter what circumstance we have to face. And if we can do those three things, then the Word of God tells us here in the last part of verse 7, there's three things that's going to happen for us and to us and with us. So if we receive Him, we walk in His Word and His ways, and we let His root take part and take hold deeply in our hearts, we will, in verse 7 says, rooted and built up. The opposite of built up is tore down. Anybody want to be tore down? Oh, sometimes I need to be tore down to be built back up because I'm attached to the wrong thing. Sometimes I need to be uprooted because I'm attached to the wrong thing and transplanted into the right thing. Amen? But that's not fun. That's not fun. When you uproot something, there's a chance that it won't make it. There's a chance that it won't make it. And so here we do three things. We receive Christ. We walk in His ways, in Him. We're rooted. And then what happens? The first thing, after we do those three things, our responsibility, He builds us up in Him. In Him. So we walk in Him. We're rooted in Him. We are built up in Him. Let me tell you something. Jesus is the hero of this story. Jesus is the hero of Cornerstone Church. I'm not the hero. Amy's not the hero. My family's not the hero. You're not the hero. Jesus is the hero of Cornerstone Church. And we, everything that we say and everything that we do must be built upon Him. Everything that we say and everything that we do must be built upon Him. But in order for us to get to that, we have to receive, we have to walk in His ways, and we have to be rooted in His Word and in a relationship with Him. And then He will build us up. And that, so that's the first thing. That's the first fruit of being rooted, of those three roots, is being built up. And then the second fruit is, or the second bloom, if you will, talking about lilies, is
established in the faith. We'll talk about faith here in a second. Established. How many of you like to be established? To me, that means stability. Stable. No matter what happens, no matter what comes my way, I'm established in Jesus. Therefore, I am stable. Cornerstone Church was established in 2014. It became stable in 2014. Again, not because of me and my family, not because of any of you, but because Jesus Christ, God, and the Holy Spirit desired Cornerstone Church to exist. They established it, not us. We are just His instruments. We are the tip of His spear, known as Cornerstone Church, to bring some sustenance and stability to a chaotic and a messed up world. So He will establish us. That's the second fruit, the second bloom of being rooted and receiving and walking in Him, is to be established in the faith. I'll talk about faith here in just a second. As you have been taught. And then the third thing, this is my favorite. I love this word. I love the word abundance, and I love the word abounding, because they're the same thing. Abounding in it with thanksgiving. Abounding means super abundant. How many of you like abundance? Okay, four people. Okay, let me ask it a different way. How many of you like super abundance? Right? I want super abundance. And the way my mind works, maybe yours don't. I always go to the physical. Super abundant health, super abundant this, that, or the other. Right? I want super abundance spiritually. That when the storms come, it doesn't rock my spirit. It doesn't uproot my spirit. That my faith in my God is established, is stable. It is concrete. It is that house built on the rock that is Jesus, not that house that is built on the sand that is the world. It is established. And with that, it is abounding. So if I receive Him, Him being Jesus, if I walk in Him, walk in His ways, pick up His thoughts, pick up His ways, His characteristics, and then if I'm rooted and allow His roots or His seed and His word to penetrate my heart and root in my heart, then I'm going to be built up, I'm going to be established or stable, and I'm going to have super abundance. Does that mean I'm going to get everything that I want in this world? No. But I've got a super abundance waiting on me eternally. And I'm going to tell you, that outweighs anything. Anything that you could receive. You may be sitting here this morning, you got $1 billion. The superabundance in eternity outweighs that. It's not even close. It's not even close. Being rooted to the right thing and the right person defeats anxiety. Being rooted to the right thing and the right person, Jesus, defeats anxiety. To be properly rooted, we must receive Christ. To be properly rooted, we must put our relationship with Jesus first. We are properly rooted in Jesus. We are built up in Him. When we are established in Jesus, we are stable. We are stable. Anxiety causes instability to our hearts, to our minds, and to our spirits. Abounding in the faith provides sustenance, superabundance, and stabilization. Abounding in the faith. Turn back to Matthew chapter 6, verse 30. Matthew chapter 6, verse 30. Turn back there. He asks a question. He asks a question at the end of verse 30. He says, will He not much clothe you, O you of little faith? O you of little faith. When we are anxious, when we allow anxiety to take over, and I've done this, when we allow anxiety to take, what we're really saying is, God, I don't trust You. I don't trust You. Trust means to take refuge in the Lord. An aspect or a characteristic of faith is trust. An aspect or a characteristic of faith is trusting God. If I say that I am faithful and I have faith in God, a characteristic of that is I'm saying, God, I trust you. I trust you in this mess. I trust you in this life. And when I allow anxiety to place its seed in my heart, and I buy into that and I let that grow root into my heart, I'm saying, God, I don't trust you. Because I'm anxious about it. God, I'm anxious about this situation because I don't think you can handle it, God. That's a lack of trust in the Lord. That's a lack of trust in my Savior, Jesus Christ. Turn over to Hebrews 11 and 6. Hebrews 11 and 6. Got a little sword drill this morning. Hebrews 11 and 6 says, but without faith, it is impossible to please Him. Who's Him? God. God. But without faith, it is impossible to please Him. For he who comes to God must believe that He is, receive Him, and that He is a rewarder of those who diligently seek Him. And so, what are you diligently seeking? The times that I get in trouble is when I'm diligently seeking myself. Or in other words, things that serve me. That serve me. And ultimately, I do that. When I do that, it causes anxiety. It causes anxiety. What we crave, we will chase. What we chase, we will serve. We will serve. Diligently seek God. Diligently seek God. When we pick up that responsibility, when we do that, guess what happens? He openly rewards those who diligently seek Him, who walk in His ways, who walk in His ways. Matthew 13. Matthew 13 and 58, and this will be the last scripture that you have to flip to. Matthew 13 and 58. It says, now He did not do many mighty works there because of their unbelief. Because of their unbelief. Or because of their lack of faith. Or because of their lack of trust in God. Unbelief. When we allow anxiety to grip us, we're essentially in a state of unbelief. God, you don't have this, so I've got to be anxious about it. I've got to worry about it. I've got to take control and do something about it. And every time that I take control, I don't know, maybe you're better than me, but every time I take control and try and do something about it, it ends up in a bigger mess than it was to begin with. And now I'm stressing the mess that I created. And now I've got anxiety about the mess that I added to. Unbelief. When we allow anxiety to grip us, we are essentially in a state of unbelief. The problem for the people, the issue for the people Jesus was preaching to was not necessarily a lack of faith. The problem was their faith was misplaced in other things instead of placed in Jesus. I don't want you to place your faith in me. Do not place your faith in each other. Place your faith in Jesus Christ. Do not misplace your faith. Trust me, I will cause you anxiety. Ask my kids. Ask my wife. Ask my friends that are closest to me. I will cause you some anxiety. Do not put your faith in me. Put your faith in Jesus Christ. The world tries to distract and confuse ideas. And the world and the enemy is working overtime to distract and confuse ideas, godly ideas. Working overtime. The enemy is working overtime to do that. It tries to give us theories of lies and empty promises. But Jesus provides the right way. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. And that's what I've got to be rooted in, is the way, the truth, and the life. Anything outside of that, I'm going to be anxious about it because it's a lie. And it doesn't lead to life, it leads to death. And it's not the right way for sure. We must be rooted in the truth and life. When we are not, we become a part of the anxiety society. When we are not a part of the truth, the way, and the life. So I have to ask you, what or who do you attach yourself to? What or who do you attach yourself to? Really think about that for a second. What is it that's so important? What is it that you got priority number one? That you're going to walk through whatever to make sure that that happens. What is it? What is it? Only you can answer that. God already knows, but be honest with yourself this morning. If it's anything outside of your relationship with Jesus Christ, these altars will be open to you. But you don't have to come to these altars. You can pray right where you're at. Jesus is ready to accept your prayer right now. If there's anything outside of a relationship with Him that's more important that you're attaching yourself to. What are you rooted in? Where do your roots run deep? If we attach ourselves to the wrong things, ideas, or people, we will find anxiety in our lives. We will worry for no reason. Seek after God. Seek after God. Rely on the teachings and promises of Jesus and see things you are anxious about. Take on a new perspective. A new perspective. And ever so often, believe it or not, just because I hold the office or the title of pastor, I'm a human being, make mistakes just like you make mistakes. And ever so often, I need a perspective transplant. I need my perspective to be uprooted and replanted in God's way and in the soil and in the loving nurture of God. Seek after God, rely on His teaching, His promises, and see your perspective change. Sometimes we need to be transplanted in order to continue to grow in Christ. So today, God, Jesus, the Holy Spirit, may be inviting you to come and to ask God to plant or to grow your roots deeper in your relationship with Him. You want to battle anxiety? You're dealing with anxiety. You're dealing with worry, fret, frustration, irritability, all of those things. You can lay those down today. And ask God, the Holy Spirit, and Jesus to grow your roots deeper, deeper in Him, in Him. Make sure before you leave this building today, make sure before you click that X or whatever it is on the live feed, that you are rooted and grounded in Christ. Nothing else or no one else. There is nothing else or no one else that can sustain you, that can give you peace and joy beyond measure like Jesus can. You want to battle anxiety? Jesus is your weapon. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank You so much for Your Word. We thank You so much for each person, for each family that is here today. We pray, dear Heavenly Father, Lord, if there's anybody here that is rooted or attached to the wrong thing, to worldly things, Lord, if those are the priority, we pray, Lord, that You'd speak to their heart and their mind and their spirit right now, Lord. We pray, Lord, that You just open our hearts and minds to receive Your Word, that seed can be planted in our hearts and that root can take hold and run deep. Lord, help us to receive You. Help us to pick up Your ways. Help us to be rooted in You. Help us, Lord, please build us up, strengthen us each and every day. Lord, we just thank You and we praise You in Jesus' name. Amen.